बुलाए। ओके
ओके
वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल ऑफ यू। अपोलजाइज फॉर कीप यू वेटिंग एंड टुडे वी हैव 41st MOES वेबिनार सेमिनार बाय अवर डिस्टिंग्विश्ड स्पीकर डॉक्टर आर कृष्णन। So, Dr. R. Krishnan specializes in climate modeling studies on scientific issues relating to climate change, Asian monsoon and water cycle. Currently, he heads the Center for Climate Change Research, CCCR at IITM MOES Pune, and is engaged in developing the in-house capability in Earth system modeling to address the science of climate change. And it is very pleasure to say that under his leadership, the CCCR developed the IITM ESM, the first global climate portal from India that contributed to CIMIP 6 and IPCC 6th assessment report. And he is a coordinating lead author in the IPCC 6 AR6 WG1 work report and chapter 8 water cycle. So he is also an MOES national awardee for the year by MOES for the, in the atmospheric sciences. So it's a great honor to have you here, sir. Welcome, over to you.
Yeah. Thank you, Vinu. First of all, I express my sincere thanks to MOES and the award committee for selecting me for the national award of the MOES in atmospheric science and technology for the year 2021. And I'm grateful to all my teachers, my mentors, colleagues, collaborators, students, postdocs at CCCR, IITM and several other institutions for all the wonderful scientific interactions and collaborations. This has been a huge learning experience for me, and I've greatly benefited from these collaborations and scientific interactions. Finally, I thank my family, friends, and all the well-wishers for their valuable support and guidance. Thank you very much. In today's talk, I'll be talking about climate change and monsoon projections. What is the status of our understanding? What are the challenges? What are the opportunities ahead? And the plan of my talk is I will focus on some of the key messages from the IPCC AR6 Working Group 1 report, some summary messages, what are the water cycle changes. I was associated with the water cycle chapter in the AR6 on the monsoons and extremes, especially the observed and future projections, and what are the changes in the projections, and what are the uncertainties in the projections, what are the sources of uncertainty, and how do we address those uncertainties, how do we reduce those uncertainties, and how do we improve the key processes in climate models. So this is the plan of my talk. So I'll go to the first slide. So this is from the AR6. One important message is the human attribution. The human influence has warmed the climate at a rate that is unprecedented in at least the last 2000 years. The planet in the last 10 years, the warming has been about 1.1 degree compared to the pre-industrial period 1850 to 1900. And this overall warming during the century, what we have seen is unprecedented in the multi-century warming in more than 100,000 years. And this is strongly linked to the greenhouse gas emission due to the human activities since the pre-industrial times. And the other important message is from the CIMIP-6 models, including the IITM Earth System model that has contributed to the CIMIP-6, we find that this observed warming trend that we see during the 20th century, the black curve, can be explained only if we include human influence, human and natural forcings, and cannot be explained by just the natural variations due to volcanic eruptions and solar irradiance changes. Especially some of these cooling episodes like the 1991-92, the Pinatubo eruption, or the El Chichon in 83, and Mount Tagang, which you see. These signatures, small episodic events you do see that can happen, last for a couple of years, but this overall warming trend has come because of the increasing greenhouse gas concentrations in the atmosphere. And the other important attribution that has come is the observed warming is driven by emissions from human activities, with greenhouse gas warming partly masked by aerosol cooling. So as I said, the warming during 2010 to 2019 was 1.1 degree. The CMIP models indicate that if we had only well-mixed greenhouse gases, this would have shown a warming of 1.5 degree. But other drivers like the aerosols and also partly land use, land cover changes and irrigation practices to a lesser extent, they have produced a cooling of about minus 0.4. So the net warming, human influence, is about 1.1 degree. So there are multiple drivers. It's not only the greenhouse gas effects. Also, we have to keep in mind there are multiple drivers that are affecting global climate change as well as regional changes in the monsoons and the water cycle. And also, one of the important messages that came out from the AR6 is the regional assessment. Climate change is already affecting every region on Earth, and this, as we have seen in the last few decades, in multiple ways. And in the future, the changes we experience will increase with further warming. So as the warming increases, the changes are going to be more severe. And so this is one of the key messages for the regional. And especially if you see the observed warming, the spatial pattern, much of the warming is located in the polar region and the high latitudes, and also significant warming over the tropical areas or the equatorial areas, both land and ocean. Land regions are warming, and this is what is simulated by the CMIP6 model at 1 degree warming. This is the present. So in the future, with 1.5 degree, which is projected in the next 20 years, the global mean temperatures will very likely exceed in all the scenarios. 1.5 will exceed in the next 20 years. We see a similar pattern of warming with the magnitude of warming being higher at the polar regions and the high latitudes. And at 2 degree, this pattern is further amplified, 2 and 4 degree warming levels. So one of the consequences of the increasing surface temperature is the water vapor will increase by 7% per degree warming. And this has a very important implication, because as the water vapor increases in the atmosphere, the precipitation also in the high latitude, mid latitude, and also over the Indian region, several areas in Central Africa and Western Africa, except the far west, precipitation is projected to increase in the future at different warming levels. And typically the global mean precipitation is projected to increase by 1 to 3% per degree warming. That is the kind of assessment, the global mean precipitation. However, extremes are going to increase. Extremes are projected to increase at 7%. Extreme precipitation events are projected to increase at 7% per degree warming. It's not just the mean is going to increase, also the variability, the wet and dry extremes are going to increase. What this means is areas which have reduced precipitation in the future, for example, the Mediterranean region, part of the western southwest Australia, South America and North America, Central American region, these are mainly the subtropical areas where precipitation is projected to decrease in the future. And whereas as the temperature increases, so the atmospheric evaporative demand is going to increase. So droughts, soil moisture is projected to decrease in these areas substantially, leading to more severe severe agricultural droughts. So the wet and dry extremes both are projected. That is the key message. And as I said, with the increasing temperature, the hot extremes we are seeing that they have increased in several regions of the world. And this is shown in the form of hexagons put along in the global map. And we can see for South Asia, there are three dots. That means there is very high confidence that the increase in the hot extremes that we have seen is because of the human contribution is significant. And there is high confidence in this. And several other regions, you can see that there is high confidence in the increase of hot extremes. Observed increase of hot extremes. And with regard to the precipitation, we also see over South Asia and other places, West Asia, East Asia, and so on, Southeast Asia, increase in heavy precipitation already. And these observed changes comes with a low confidence because of limited agreement across models. But we do see that the attribution studies indicate that human contributions have contributed to observed changes in the heavy precipitation in these areas. And lastly, many areas, as I said, especially the Mediterranean and the West Central Asia, where droughts are projected in the future because of the reduced rainfall and increased atmospheric evaporative demand, we can see the droughts are also projected to increase. These droughts are increasing there is medium confidence, medium to low confidence that the droughts increasing severity and frequency of these droughts is because of the human influence. So what about the future? If in the future we have five scenarios, SSPs, this is shared socioeconomic pathways, and going up to the end of the 21st century, the SSP 119, which is the very low emission scenario, and the SSP 126 is the low emission scenario. The 245 is a kind of the middle of the road, and we have two high emission scenarios, the 370 and 585. What we find is, as I said in the, earlier, that in the next 20 years, we will cross the 1.5 degree warming in all the scenarios. And only in the very low emission scenarios, during the end of the 21st century, the mean temperatures are projected to be less than 2 degrees. In all the other scenarios, even including, although the very likely range in SSP 126 is less than 2, there are some models show that we could exceed the 2 degree even in the SSP 126. And the SSP 245, the very likely estimate by end of the century is about 2.7 degrees. And with the high emission scenarios, it is more than 4 degree warming relative to 1850 to 1900. So global warming is there to continue during the 21st century. And what does it mean for the extremes in the both the temperature and the precipitation? So any a 10-year hot event that that happened once in the 1850 to 1900 is already happening at the present 2.8 times. It's become more frequent, and at 1.5 degree it is projected to become more than 4 times frequent. And with higher warming levels, it's going to become more frequent. And also, when you look at a 50-year event, which is a more severe event, we are already seeing that it's occurring at 4.8 times more frequent compared to the pre-industrial times. And with higher warming levels, this frequency of these 50-year events are also projected to increase. So clearly, the hot extremes are projected to increase in both in frequency and intensity with every additional increment of warming. That is one message. Likewise, heavy precipitation over land, 10-year events, for example, what was occurring once in 1850 to 1900 is now occurring at a frequency of 1.3 times, about 30% more. And at 1.5 degree warming, this is at around 1.5 times more. And so with increasing warming events, increasing warming levels, the heavy precipitation over land is projected to increase. Likewise, the frequency of droughts, agricultural and ecological drought, which is based on the soil moisture criteria, they are also projected to increase with higher warming levels. So this is an important message. This is from a global, this is based on the entire global information. And now coming to the water cycle chapter, in which I was associated as a CLA, and we have three CLAs in our chapter, 13 lead authors, 48 contributing authors, and two chapter scientists, two review editors. And this is a more of a process-based chapter. And in this chapter, we assess the global water cycle, which has the global water stores. If you see, nearly 97%, 96.6% of the water resources, the water stores are in the oceans and seas and bays. The saline groundwater and the surface freshwater, they contribute to a meager 3% or so. And out of this 3%, 3.65%, what is really usable, the surface freshwater in the form of the fresh groundwater, the permafrost, fresh lakes and all, this contributes only 1.8%, which is really accessible to human. And the other sources of freshwater like the ice and the glaciers and snow are not really accessible to human consumption. So terrestrial freshwater, what is really usable and accessible, is a very scarce commodity. And with climate change, this is going to become so the changes in the water cycle are going to be impacted. And this has profound implications. And we also assess the exchange of water fluxes across the different components, from the ocean to the atmosphere, and from what is the water vapor flux from the land, from the cryosphere. And you can see the main source of the water vapor flux is from the ocean evaporation. And this contributes to the precipitation over the ocean. It's also transported to the land areas. So substantial land precipitation also comes because of evaporation happening over the oceanic areas. And also land evaporation is also contributing to the land precipitation. And why I am emphasizing ocean evaporation is because for the monsoons, when we are talking about the monsoons, the main evaporation is happening over the oceanic areas, which is the main source of water vapor to feed the monsoon precipitation. So this is very important. And so, as I said, in this chapter on water cycle changes, we have explored the changing water cycle and its sensitivity to multiple drivers based on multiple lines of evidence. How it has, what happened in the past, what is happening in the present, and what is happening in the future, based on paleoclimate observations, historical observations, instrumental data, and models for the historical period and future projections. And this is a process-based chapter. We have an introduction, we have a section on the theoretical basis of water cycle changes, and we also have a section on the observed changes with detailed attribution and the future projection. So the 8.3 and 8.4 go parallel, hand in hand. The subsections in these two sections. There is a section on the non-linearities and internal variability of water cycle. What are our limits to predicting the water cycle changes? We also discuss potential abrupt changes in the water cycle. And then there's a final remarks. And this is a quick guide of the different topics and subsections. We discuss evapotranspiration, global water cycle intensity, intertropical convergence zone, tropical rain belts, monsoon, precipitation, runoff, stream flow, flooding, soil moisture, aridity and drought, water vapor and its transport. I will focus on monsoons in my presentation. This is a quick summary of the South Asian monsoon, which all of you are very familiar. We need a land-ocean thermal contrast to initially set up the monsoon circulation. But once it is set up, the clouds that form due to the condensation of water vapor, it releases a huge amount of latent heat. And this latent heating maintains the monsoon circulation through a positive feedback. So basically, the monsoon circulation and rainfall are convectively coupled. And of course, we see year-to-year variations in the seasonal rainfall, which can be affected by different climatic drivers like the ENSO and the IOD and other modes of climate variability, as well as external drivers such as volcanic events or aerosol changes or due to greenhouse gas forcing. So internal dynamics and external drivers influence the variability of monsoon. This is a quick summary. So as I said, there are different drivers in addition to greenhouse gases, aerosol emissions in the northern hemisphere. Particularly now, there is data from the shortwave radiation measurements from several stations in the northern hemisphere. These are known as the GBA data sets. They are looking at the energy balance by measuring the different radiation components. So in the northern hemisphere, many parts of Europe, North America, and Asia, due to the enhanced emission of anthropogenic aerosols, the solar radiation decreased, especially during the summertime. Summertime solar radiation, this particularly from the 60s, 70s, and 80s, this is known as the dimming effect. And this reduction, this reduced solar radiation in the northern hemisphere, we also find that has led to decreases in the northern hemisphere summer monsoon land precipitation. This was a paper by Paulson et al. And this you can see in the different data sets, the GPCC, CRU. So when you look at the northern hemispheric summer monsoon land region, during this period from the 60s to the late 80s, there was a substantial dimming, and also the precipitation declined, mostly in the parts of West Africa and the monsoon region, also over the South Asia and the Southeast Asia and the East Asian monsoons. And later, there were some kind of regulation norms in the emissions, especially in Europe and North America. And the aerosol emissions decreased subsequently after the 90s due to regulation norms. And so there has been some recovery in the dimming effect. And also with the increasing greenhouse gas forcing that continued, it appears to have improved the monsoon precipitation in some of these areas, particularly the West African monsoon. And this contrasting signatures we do of the aerosol, and the, because the GHG is trying to increase the, favor the precipitation enhancement, whereas the aerosols try to offset them. So this contrasting, the offsetting influence of the aerosol compared to the GHG is captured by the CMIP-6 models. This is the multi-models. Although the magnitude of the variability that you see, the observed precipitation decrease that you see, that magnitude is not, the magnitude of that change is not seen in the models, although they get the contrasting signatures. So in the future, you see just with the aerosol forcing, that is a blue line, precipitation shows a decrease, whereas with the aerosol only forcing, you see an increase. And the combined experiment with both the aerosol and the precipitation, you can see a all forcing experiment, an initial decrease and a subsequent increase thereafter. So these are multiple drivers, and there was this paper on the fingerprinting based on the CMIP-5 models, Bonfields et al. This is also reported in the chapter 8 about the fingerprint of the greenhouse gas forcing and the aerosol forcing on the precipitation. Generally, as I said, the GHG forcing, you can see warming over all the land areas globally. You can see a global signature, particularly in the high latitudes, polar regions. And over with the precipitation fingerprint, you see an increase. And in some areas, in the subtropical areas, there is a decrease. Over India and parts of Africa, we see an increase in the precipitation due to GHG fingerprint. And when we come to the aerosol, the pattern is you see cooling over the land areas in the northern hemisphere, a kind of a cooling effect, especially due to the sulfate aerosols, which are more of a scattering type of aerosols. And you see an asymmetric pattern, cooling to the north and warming to the south. And this type of intrahemispheric asymmetry in the energy and the energy input into the system, studies have shown that this will lead to a southward shift of the ITCZ. And because of that, many areas in the tropics and the monsoon regions, precipitation shows the aerosol fingerprint is a decrease. And you see a shift in the precipitation to the south of the equator. And so the contrasting effects of the GHG and the aerosol, we also see the signatures in terms of the aridity fingerprint. So we have to keep in mind there are multiple drivers, and especially this is applicable, it applies to the monsoon. And in the AR5 assessment, the definition of the regional monsoons was based on the global monsoon definition. We have slightly changed. We have in the AR6, we are using the definition of regional monsoons based on published literature and based on the regional studies and giving importance to the regional processes of each monsoon regions. And this is described in the annex in the IPCC AR6. And the black lines are showing the domains of the global monsoons, which was used in the AR5 assessment. You can see the global monsoon domain includes covers many of the oceanic regions. And in the AR6, we have restricted to the monsoon regions over the land areas only. And also we have excluded in the AR5, the global monsoon, the South Asian, South African region and the equatorial America, which are shown by the stippled dots. That was considered as a monsoon in the AR5, which is not in our case. In the AR6, these are regions with strong seasonality in precipitation, but it's not clear that whether they really represent monsoon regions. So we do have assessed the seasonal changes in these two areas, the equatorial America and South Africa, but whether they qualify as monsoon regions is still a topic of debate. So what we have is the six regional monsoons, the Asia, South Asian, South Asia and Southeast Asian monsoon, which is shown by this pink color, then the East Asian monsoon by the purple, the Australia and Maritime continent monsoon by shown by this yellow, the West African monsoon by this gray, North American monsoon and the South American monsoons. These are the six monsoon regions. And this is a nice schematic produced by Sabin, my colleague. We have done a detail. This is for the observed period 1951 to 2014. What are the changes in the observed precipitation? I'll just focus on the South Asian region, where we see a significant but a slight decrease in the monsoon precipitation during this period, a kind of declining trend in different data sets. And this is captured in the all-forcing experiment of the CMIP-6 models, this decreasing trend with significant variation of spread across the models. And if we have only GHG forcing, we do see an increase in the precipitation. And with the aerosol-only forcing, you see a contrasting effect, a declining trend in the precipitation. So the contrasting signatures of these two drivers are clearly seen. We also see this over the East Asian monsoon and also over West Africa in the models. However, we have to keep in the West African monsoon region, there's a significant decadal variability in the rainfall itself. This is something I will be coming to. So there's a strong interdecadal variability in the rainfall for the West African monsoon region, in addition to the anthropogenic drivers. And with regard to the future projected changes, what we find is in the near term, in the middle and the long term, that is from 2040 to 2060 and 2080 to 2100, the South Asian, the East Asian and the West African monsoon, all of them are projected to increase with increasing warming levels. In the near term, we do see an increase in the projection, but the problem is in the near term, the internal variability is going to be a very dominant factor. This will be an important source of uncertainty. That is, the next 20 years, what happens to the monsoon is going to be determined a lot by the internal variability in the system. Because in the future, as GHG forcings are going to dominate and the aerosols, if they are going to be reduced, we expect that the monsoon is projected to increase over South Asia, Southeast Asia, East Asia, and West Africa and other regions in the different scenarios. So one of the things, and this is also from the CMIP multi-six models, we are able to attribute the human influence on the precipitation changes, observed changes during the historical period, and also the future changes. But the question is, there is a large uncertainty. Intermodal spread is very large. Across the models, the spread is large. This is an important uncertainty. And how do we address that? So that is the main issue. How do we reduce the uncertainties in projections of the regional monsoons? So that is going to be my focus. So first of all, what are the sources of uncertainties, precipitation uncertainties? So it can come from the model response uncertainty. There is a wide spread across the model, intermodal spread or range projected by a set of climate models. Also a representation of key physical processes like atmospheric convection, aerosol microphysics, effects on clouds and precipitation, land surface processes, and so on. Also, high resolution models, what are the added values? So that is still, we need to do a lot of work in finding out what are the added value that we get from high resolution models, although they have shown significant potential for improving the extremes at least. and convection permitting models. And the other source of uncertainty comes from the internal variability, as I said, like the modes of variability, like the El Nino Southern Oscillation or the IOD or the Equinu or the PDO, the Pacific Decadal Oscillation. So how they are going to change in the coming 20, 30 years is going to be an important source of, has an important implication for the monsoons. And it's also a source of uncertainty when it comes to climate projections. And also natural forcings like volcanic eruptions. And recently we have been seeing an eruption somewhere in Spain. And these major eruptions are a source of uncertainty. And this unpredictable nature of these internal forcing and natural forcings, they can lower our degree of confidence in projecting regional water cycle changes, including monsoons, especially in the near term. I'll come to this important point. And there are also non-linearities across different global warming levels, non-linearities in the atmospheric circulation and precipitation, also land surface processes and feedbacks, for example, the land surface runoff, groundwater recharge, snow melt, soil moisture and evaporation. And there's also a potential for abrupt change. For example, it can happen due to collapse of the Atlantic meridional overturning circulation and changes in the Amazon deforestation and drying, the greening of Sahara and Sahel, and as well as dust emissions due to land use changes. So, although the abrupt changes may be unlikely, but there is a potential. So that we have to keep in mind, that is also an uncertainty. And of course, the scenarios, what scenarios we are going to use, there are uncertainties in the scenarios that we are using in the models. So now coming to the natural forcing uncertainty, as I said, that the volcanic eruptions as one of the important sources of uncertainty. Recently, there is a paper by Aubrey et al. They say that if you have these big eruptions like Pinatubo that happened in 1991, which was one of the most powerful eruptions of the 21st century, they say that it can, especially in a warming climate, as climate warms, the height of the troposphere can increase in the tropics due to warming, and therefore the buoyancy of these parts, the aerosols can, so the atmosphere can be more buoyant, and the aerosols which are injected by the volcanic eruptions can go high in the stratosphere, and they can produce a cooling that can be much stronger. So they say that in a warming climate, as climate warms, these volcanic eruptions can have a big impact on in terms of cooling compared to a scenario where there was the warming was much less. So in a warming climate, this is a very recent study. So they say that new research indicates that cooling effect from rare large eruptions like Pinatubo will increase, whereas the effect of more frequent smaller eruptions will be reduced. This is one important point. And also the other point is large volcanic eruptions can trigger El Ninos. This was a very important work that came out in 2017 by Kodri et al. They showed eruptions like Pinatubo or Hagang. These eruptions typically when the stratosphere goes and the aerosols go into the stratosphere and they produce a large scale cooling, they can also trigger El Nino like conditions 1 year later. And this is what is seen in the model simulations, and it's also seen in the observations. And in fact, people, because the ENSO monsoon correlation, after Krishna Kumar's famous work that the ENSO monsoon correlation has weakened, there was a study by Marwan and Kurt. They showed that they tried to analyze this this phase synchronization, the phase of the ENSO and the Indian monsoon can get synchronized during certain epochs. And they did a phase synchronization analysis based on the ENSO and Indian monsoon time series. And they found that whenever there were events, big volcanic events, these two oscillatory systems, the phase was getting synchronized. So they raised a very important idea that it is not just the amplitude of these variations, but you have to also look at the phase of these oscillations and how they can get synchronized. So volcanic, they suggested that volcano can be as an forcing, it can produce, lead to synchronization of these oscillatory systems. And and this work we later on tried to take up, this is a work by Manmeet, our colleague, who did several large ensemble experiments using the IITM ESM, 160 ensemble simulations to fingerprint the effect of volcanic forcing on the ENSO and monsoon coupling. And he also used various paleo data, various proxy data, various observational data to show that volcanic events indeed have a significant role in producing the synchronization of these two coupled systems. I'm not going to these details, but so these type of, so the volcanic forcing is one of the key uncertainties when we are talking about monsoons and the large scale climate itself. And how do we improve the processes? So I want to just quickly touch upon the key processes in the climate models. One is improving the organization of monsoon convection, the cloud systems, the organization of the mesoscale convective systems, and the latent heating due to the release by these convective systems, that the structure of that, the vertical structure, because they have a very important role in the circulation of the monsoon and the precipitation. And we also have to understand how do we improve the coupling between the tropical circulation, large scale, and the organized convection, ITCZ and rain belts, and there are uncertainties in the aerosol and cloud interactions. We now understand a few things about the warm rain processes thanks to the CAPEX program and the HACPL efforts. But how do we represent these things in the model? And so there are multiple approaches. There is a thought that we should go for very high resolution. There's one school of thought that says that a kilometer scale model will be helpful. This is one school of thinking. And the other school of thinking, they say that we have new developments. There's a large amount of data, like so data-driven approaches. So use artificial intelligence, machine learning to extract patterns from these data, geospatial data, both using observations and model to understand these processes. And now there are also thinking that we have only one type of model. You need a hierarchy of models, models of different complexities, very simple models, go to intermediate hierarchical models and more complex models. So hierarchy of models. And there's also a view advocated by Professor Kerry Emanuel and say, who says that you need a more balanced approach of having basic, advancing both basic understanding by combining theory, observations, and models. So there are different approaches. How do we go about? Those are important things. So one of the things that we still understand is in the future, as many of the models project that monsoons, global land monsoons are projected in the future, this happens mostly because of the increase of the water vapor. Due to the increased ability of the atmosphere to hold water vapor, the water vapor convergence increases due to more evaporation. But actually the convergence due to the wind itself decreases. And this has been a paradigm. And they say in the future, the monsoon circulation can weaken and the tropical circulation will weaken. But why the precipitation increases is because the water vapor convergence will increase. So this was suggested in the AR5. Still that idea holds. But now there are certain limitations. I will come to that. So this is a simplified illustration that for the monsoon. So this is the present. You have a land sea contrast. In the future, as the land gets warmer and there is more, and also the oceans get warmer, there is more evaporation, there is more enhanced transport of moisture. Basically, the water vapor increases, and this can lead to more convergence of the water vapor. This can increase the potential for heavy rainfall. That is possible. But thermodynamic argument suggests that because the water vapor increases at a much faster rate, but at the same time, the precipitation will increase at a very modest rate. And thermodynamic argument suggests that when this happens, the circulation will actually weaken due to increased static stability. And so is this true? Does this really hold? That is one of the questions. So in fact, with increased moisture at 7% per degree warming, heavy precipitation can increase at the same rate. That is what the assessments show. But now the question is whether the tropical circulation, whether the monsoon circulation will really weaken. That is one of the questions which we still don't understand. Because this logic was came from a paper, a very famous paper by Held and Soden. They argued that the physics behind the weakening circulation but more precipitation is valid for closed domains, and where precipitation approximately the first order balance between precipitation is related to the vertical velocity, product of vertical velocity and specific humidity. So if you are talking about change in the precipitation, change in the humidity and change in the vertical velocity from these models, climate models, water vapor increases at about 7% per degree Kelvin, whereas precipitation is about only 2%. So what this implies is the vertical velocity should decrease at a rate of about 5% per degree warming. So this is what is indicated in all the CMIP models. Now, does it really hold? In fact, we have used a very high resolution model at a 35 kilometer resolution. It's zoomed over the Indian region. It's a global model where we did projections for the historical period, not the future. This is for the historical period. We have a natural experiment only with greenhouse gases and all forcing experiment where we have forcing due to greenhouse gases, aerosol, land use change. Another experiment only with the aerosol forcing. So this monsoon, because of this high resolution, this has a fairly good representation of the precipitation over the Western Ghats in Myanmar, and a good coupling between the circulation and precipitation. And in the all forcing experiment, we do see that for the historical period compared to the natural, we do see a decrease in the precipitation and the weakening of the circulation, which we attribute due to the effect of the aerosols, because this signature emerges in the aerosol forcing run. You can see a decrease of precipitation when only the aerosol forcings are applied and a weakening of the circulation. Now, how about the GHG forcing run? What we see, although in the historical period, there was substantial increase in the greenhouse gases and also warming, we do see the signature of the increase in precipitation and also a strengthening of the circulation. So this is very counterintuitive compared to the other models. Although this compares well with what we see in observations, this is against most of the CMIP models. We see that the precipitation enhancement that we have seen is associated with actual intensification of the monsoon circulation. So we need more work to really understand what is the coupling between, does the South Asian monsoon really weaken under global warming? The question remains still unanswered. And there was a paper by Sabir Ali et al. He told us that many of the CMIP models have problems in the way they simulate the convective and the stratiform types of precipitation. And if you see the future projections, most of the models, they project more rainfall over India. This was in the CMIP 5, both in the RCP 4.5 and 8.5 scenario with increased warming. And all the models show that this precipitation is coming because of the increase in the convective rain. But if you see the present day models, all these models exaggerate the convective precipitation compared to the stratiform. And if you see the TRIM data set, actually the ratio of convective and stratiform precipitation is 50-50. But all these models are overdoing the convective precipitation. So once you do the type of latent heating associated with these two types of precipitating systems is very different. And the dynamical responses they drive is also very different. And so there are huge uncertainties, and this is one of the areas we need to improve. And now with the TRIM data, because of the precipitation radar, we are able to understand the latent heating due to the monsoon precipitation, due to tropical precipitation, where the stratiform type of precipitation, you can see maximum at around 400 hectopascal. And these are very different from so the heating profile is very, very different compared to the convective type of rain. And this has implications for the intra-seasonal oscillations. This was a very famous work by Krishnamurthy and Balme in 1976, where they recognized that the cloud processes and the convection and the radiation convection processes, how they interact with the monsoon circulation is going to be very important for the 10 to 20 day mode. They said that the oscillations on the 10 to 20 day time scale which happen in the system is associated with this cloud radiation and circulation feedbacks. And more recently with the TRIM data, Shige et al. Have shown that when you look at the boreal summer intra-seasonal oscillation, the propagation in the different phases, it's basically, they say this is with the precipitation radar. It basically starts at the southern tip of the Western Ghats. And so the both the circulation and the convection patterns, slowly they propagate northward. And so these are going to be very important. And also the ITCZ movements, we see the seasonal changes in the monsoon are because of the strong seasonal variation, migrations of the ITCZ. This is again famous paper by work book by Asnani et al. And now there are new studies talking about the ITCZ dynamics from the dynamics from based on the ITCZ perspective. On an annual mean, when you look at the zonal mean, ITCZ is located around 6 degrees north of the equator. And this is where the ascending branch of the Hadley cell happens. And actually, if you look at the energy transport, which happens in the Hadley cell, it is happening in the upper troposphere, in the upper branch of the Hadley cell. And basically, the transport is out of the hemisphere where the ITCZ is located. So the atmospheric energy fluxes will basically take out the energy and transport it to the other end, hemisphere where the ITCZ is not located. So basically the ITCZ stays in the warmer hemisphere where the atmosphere is heated more strongly by radiation or by ocean heat transport. This is important. And this is an important part. So the Hadley cell is very closely tied to the ITCZ. That's an important point. And now there is a review paper by Schneider et al. In 2014. So where they argued, they discussed about the dynamics, migrations and dynamics of the ITCZ. So basically they argue in the ITCZ, you can see that there is convergence of the low level winds and moisture, which is converging into the region of the ITCZ. There is an upward motion and a flow aloft. And basically in the ITCZ, the transport of energy is at the upper branches of the Hadley cell. That is where the energy is transported, and it is transported to the other hemisphere where the ITCZ is not located. But they further said that because in the tropics you have the easterly winds, it is dominated by the easterlies. These easterly trade winds in the equator, they will also drive shallow overturning circulations in the ocean. So they call it as the subtropical cells in the oceans. These are very shallow circulations, and these shallow ocean circulations also transport heat to poleward. And so this poleward transport of heat is also an important, and this happens more prominently in the Atlantic. And this is going to be important in determining the ITCZ migration. That is the essence of that paper. Whereas when you look at the atmospheric energy transport, basically the moist static energy transports, as I said, it happens in the upper tropospheric levels. And more when we look at the zonal variation, the strongest transports happen near the regions at the mid-latitude regions, near the Kuroshio region, and the also over the Atlantic Ocean. Very strong poleward transport. And so these are transport by the baroclinic eddies. They also transport a lot of heat away from the tropics to the extratropics. So we really have to understand the ITCZ migration in from a dynamical perspective. And another nice paper was how to understand the monsoons based on global energy constraints. So the constraints that apply for the ITCZ on momentum and energy, they also govern the variability of rainfall belt in the ITCZ. And but the only thing is, when you look at the continental scale monsoons, they are very different. They can be substantially different from that of the ITCZ. So they say that global energetic global constraints, what you see, also applies for the regional monsoons. But we have to also combine the regional physics, the local physics for the monsoons. And in fact, they show this schematic. This is the zonal. This is the latitude in the y-axis. This is the ITC. This is the rain precipitation in the ITCZ. The gray line, the light gray line, is the climatological ITCZ. And this is where you can see around 6 degrees north, you have the maximum precipitation. And this is on a particular day, on a 27th July 2015, substantial variations compared to the, for each regional monsoon, compared to the climatological mean. So they are highlighted, and also you can see they have put the contours of the water vapor. So the regional monsoons, when you are looking at them, they can be substantially different from the ITCZ from a regional perspective. So we have to combine this global energetics and the regional physics. That is the main thing. And as I said, also cloud aerosol cross interaction. This is a very important thing. How do aerosols in the different environment, how do they help in the formation of the cloud droplets? How do the cloud droplets grow, and what is its impact on the precipitation? There are major uncertainties, especially in the Indian monsoon region, where we have known recognized papers by Konwar et al, Utsav Bhoumik, many research key findings from the HACPL and CAPEX. They have shown that this is all because of warm rain processes. Still, we don't know, our representation of these in the models is not adequate. We need to improve that. And also, we have to keep in mind that there are also intranual and decadal variations. In the AR5, it was suggested that how will ENSO change, for example. This is a large, the dominant ocean atmosphere coupled process in the climate system. Where there is a coupling between the Walker circulation and the trade winds and the SST gradients through what is known as a Bjerknes feedback. So once you have these strong trade winds, they increase the upwelling, and so they elevate the thermocline in the eastern Indian Ocean. And whereas in the western Indian Ocean, these trade winds, they depress the thermocline. They maintain warm SST. So the SST gradient maintain the easterly trade winds, and the trade winds maintain the SST gradient through a thermocline feedback. So now, not what happens during El Nino is when the SST gradient, because as the trade wind weakens, the upwelling weakens, and slowly the warm waters from the western Pacific, they start moving eastward, and as the upwelling reduces, the sea surface temperature increases in the central and eastern Pacific, upwelling reduces, and there is more, the convection also shifts eastward. Now, climate models suggest that as you increase the warming, with higher warming, you get an El Nino-like pattern. It is not an El Nino because of the weakening of the upwelling and because of the weakening of the trade winds. They say the Walker circulation will weaken, the trade wind will weaken, upwelling will weaken, and you get an El Nino-like response. And now, some recent studies by Seeger, Markin, and et al. Have contested this argument. They say that, in fact, during the recent decades, the Walker circulation has not weakened. In fact, it has become stronger, and the tropical Pacific SST gradient has become stronger. It is in stark contrast with what the CMIP models show with respect to the rising greenhouse gases. So these are very strong implications for the monsoon. And also the IOD, that's another important mode of variability. We have recently several monsoons like the 1994-2019, where we got excessive rainfall over India. It was associated with this Indian Ocean dipole mode. There is in one of our very early studies, this was for the 1994 monsoon, where is a strong, because of this cooling in the east and increased upwelling over the high pressure region and their suppressed convection. Due to the divergent flow, there is a transport of moisture from this region which can feed the precipitation and increase the cyclonic activity. The entire monsoon trough can get strengthened and precipitation can increase. And this we also see in the 2019 very extreme positive IOD by Satyabhan Ratna et al. So June was kind of very dry conditions. By September, as the IOD picked up, the monsoon also significantly enhanced. So interestingly, I want to highlight that the IITM ESM, we have recently looked at the IOD simulation. It turns out that this is one of the very good models. It's among the top models in capturing the IOD pattern and its teleconnection with the Indian monsoon. This is by Prajish et al. This is conditionally accepted. I'm not going into the details. And we have also extreme precipitation. As I said, precipitation extremes will increase. So there are different types of precipitation. For example, the Gujarat and the Maharashtra and the western parts of India, they get substantial rain due to these mid-tropospheric cyclones. These vortices, you see them at 600 millibar, 700 millibar, 500 millibar, not at these at the lower levels, and they can lead to substantial rains. And in fact, this is some snapshot of 3-day rain accumulations. Over the western India, we can see in 3-day rain accumulations of 70 millimeters. And these are associated with strong mid-level convergence. And what in one of our studies by Ayantika Chaudhary et al., we find that these MTCs develop, they are associated with northward propagating rain bands, and the MCS associated with this, they have a kind of top heavy heating and typical of stratiform clouds, which lead to what, because of the strong gradient in the heating, so the PV maximum leads to a generation of a vorticity at the mid-tropospheric levels. And this is also assisted by the subsidence that happens over the West Central Asia. This is the concept that Ramej et al. Had produced. So extremes happen through a variety of processes, and there are also extreme precipitation in the Himalayan region, like the Uttarakhand heavy rainfall. And Villur et al., they analyzed something like 34 rain events in this region. They all have very similar characteristics of the 2013 heavy precipitation event, which was associated with a low pressure system that formed in the bay and very quickly moved. It was a very, very rapid advance and onset of the monsoon. And at the same time, there was a very deep intruding trough, and it was very persistent trough from the polar regions and the mid-latitude region, leading to strong convergence of water vapor. And this triggered these heavy rains. So the point is, as I said, with every 1 degree warming, if water vapor is going to increase, and if there is going to be moisture transported further by these synoptic systems, you can experience for the same event the magnitude, the strong water vapor converge with future warming. The intensity of rainfall events can be really strong. And this event was not restricted, it was widespread. Several stations reported more than 200 millimeters of rain in a day. And so clearly you can see this was from House et al. They documented the movement of the water vapor. So the low pressure systems, you can see clearly, this is at 500 millibar, moving from the bay from 13 June to 17 June, the strong interaction with the mid-latitude system. And the moisture from the Bay of Bengal, also from the Arabian Sea, increasing the water vapor in this region, leading to the heavy precipitation. So if you see from a global perspective, you have this polar low, a very strong southward intruding polar low, and this is a subtropical jet. And the confluence of these two in this region, and when you look at the isentropic surface, you can see both the extratropical influence is at 330 Kelvin. You can see both the low-level circulation going towards India, and this is also the extratropical coming from the polar regions converging into this region, and due to the strong water vapor convergence can create these extreme events. The models are able to do, this was a paper by Sushmita Joseph et al., they also, well, these models at CFS 126 and at the CFS, this is at T382, they are able to capture this precipitation well in advance, but they say that they fail to predict the mid-latitude influence. Also, we see the structure of the circulation there are some signatures of the westward moving low, which is better captured in the high resolution model compared to the 126, but there are also substantial differences in the east-west pattern of the vorticity over the Indian region. So clearly we need to improve these things, these features in the model. The other point is the Leh flash floods. This is immediately a week after the July 2010 Pakistan flooding, heavy floods over the cold desert of the Leh region. And it led to torrential flooding. And this paper by Rasmussen House, they looked at the satellite data, Meteosat, TRIM, and what they argued was, in the Tibetan Plateau, there is a strong diurnal variation of convection. So the mesoscale convective systems which develop in this region during the afternoon and evening, they kind of propagate towards westward. And when there is a strong westerly flow from the Bay of Bengal, which brings in moisture, the moisture flow converging in the Ladakh region can trigger extreme precipitation event. So diurnal variation of convection in Tibetan Plateau is an important feature. So the Tibetan Plateau is also warming at a very fast rate. And so with increasing moisture, so this is an important element. What will happen to flooding in heavy precipitation and flooding? And another point is the cyclones in the Arabian Sea, they are becoming more frequent. And this is a study by Medha Deshpande and Roxy Cole from CCCR. They are telling that Arab frequency of intensity of Arabian Sea cyclones are getting stronger. And how do we project them? So this is the Tauke, which the IMD and the NCMRWF forecast were able to capture very nicely. But the question is, what will happen in the future? And it's some of the cyclones like Tauke, they move west northward towards the Indian coast, but there are also several systems that go into Oman, like the Gonu in 2007. What is their impact with climate change as it warms up and with more water vapor in the atmosphere? And interestingly, we have developed the IATM ESM. We now have a much global version, a T574, with the same ESM, the atmospheric model. We are running with just the SST, prescribed SST. So this is a 27 kilometer grid, and my colleague Sabin looked at some of the examples of Arabian Sea cyclone. And interestingly, it's a AMIP type of run, and it is able to capture some of these westward moving cyclone in the model. And so the Tauke, and the, some of the systems have wind speed of about 150 kilometer per hour, 150, 160 kilometers in the observation. In the model, we are able to get it close to about this is from the daily data, about close to about 80, 90 kilometers per hour. But when we look at maybe hourly or few hour, 3 hour means, we may be getting more intense cyclones. We do see these westward moving systems in the model. And also the model shows some of these northward moving systems like the Tauke type of systems that form in the Southern Arabian Sea and move southern Arabian Sea and move northward. So the clearly with increasing humidity in the atmosphere, increasing sea surface temperature, what will be its impact on the monsoon? What will be its impact on the heavy precipitation? And also some of these pre-monsoon circulations, when they have occurred, they have also delayed the monsoon onset. So they have also consequences to the monsoon. So clearly the monsoon, so there are several key questions that we need to understand. So this is my summary slide. The monsoon variability and change, it is basically a multi-scale interactive phenomena. We have made significant advances in our understanding and also made projections. And also in the shorter time scale, in the seasonal, sub-seasonal time scales, we have made significant improvements. But there are also major scope that we need to improve the predictive capabilities as the climate changes. We need to reduce the uncertainties in the projections. We need to have a framework based on global energy constraints and the regional monsoon complexities. This would mean how to improve the representation of the organized convection, latent heating, that's going to affect the regional circulation, the warm rain processes, orographic precipitation, mid-level circulation, aerosol cloud interaction. These are some to name a few. And also the large-scale SST gradients associated with these modes of variability, they are going to be very fundamental for the monsoon in regulating the tropical and monsoon precipitation. This is important for the mean variability and extremes for all of them by altering the heat and moisture fluxes, the convective activity and large-scale circulation. So we need to have process and predictive understanding. This involves combining observations and models for advancing predictive understanding of the coupled system, ocean atmosphere coupled system on different time scales, ocean atmosphere system moorings. Like already we have the Rama mooring in the Indian Ocean, the Pacific Ocean has mooring, the Argo float satellite observations, radar observations, especially for the, it will be required in the Himalayan region and the Indian land region. And we need to have a strong data simulation because the initial conditions are going to be very, very important if you want to predict the extreme events. The vertical structure of the water vapor, the circulation patterns, and how to improve the data assimilation. Professor TNK was doing physical initialization, and this was a very important, how to assimilate precipitation products, improve the initial conditions. That is something we probably need to consider in the future, and improving the and large ensemble climate model experiments and improving high resolution models. So these are my key summary points. With this, I come to the end of my talk. Thanks a lot for your kind attention. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Krishnan. That was an excellent talk. We all enjoyed, and it has collected several questions. So I have collected few questions from the chat box. And
shall I unshare my screen?
I think you can unshare and then read the question and answer the questions. Yeah, questions are in the chat box. Please read the questions so that audience all will hear what are the questions we selected. Okay. And click the chat box, you will get the questions.
Chat box. Yeah, I have what has led to the anomalous first question I see from Vinu Valsala. What has led to the anomalous increasing temperature gradients in the polar regions of the northern hemisphere?
So in fact, that's a question from the audience, sir. So I am posting.
Thank you, Vinu. Yeah, so that's a good point. So when we see more, even this has been known from earlier, the AR5, AR6, AR3, AR4 and so on. The response to the greenhouse gas forcing is results in stronger warming in the high and the polar regions. And basically the temperature sensitivity is very strong in the mid latitudes. So, and one more thing in the polar regions, what happens is as the ice starts melting, so normally in the polar regions, the temperatures are low and there is ice covered regions, the albedo is very high. So as the temperature increases, the albedo starts decreasing. And this leads to the amplification of the temperatures. So the warming increases, you absorb more heat. So the temperature in the polar regions increase. So this is known as the Arctic amplification. And people are telling that this can also affect the temperature gradient between the mid latitude and the polar regions. And the polar vortex, which is usually confined, can weaken at that time. And the jet stream can weaken because of this. And this leads to meanders in the jet stream. And this can also lead to extreme weather in the mid latitudes. And also now they are also thinking it can also affect lower latitudes. So usually the polar regions is there's a feedback between the ice albedo. Feedback is one of the factors. I think dynamically, generally in the high latitudes, the temperature response is very strong. Any perturbation you make, first signal you see the geopotential height, the temperature signal you start seeing in the strong variations. The signal is very strong in the mid latitudes, high latitudes. The signal in the tropics is generally weaker, but for the tropics, the precipitation and changes are going to be more important. That is the key point. So temperature signal is more for the high latitude. That is my simple understanding. We see a negative positive rainfall pattern between of the Western Ghat. Is this between north and southwestern? Is it related to LLJ? How this is going to? Yeah, that's a good question. So generally, I think what we are seeing is the in one of our earlier studies with a high resolution model, what we find is when the winds slow down, when the southwest monsoon winds slow down, the orographic as they impinge the Western Ghats, because this was at a resolution of 20 kilometer global model, and we also see this at the 35 kilometer model also, we are able to reasonably resolve the Western Ghats. What we find is as the wind slow down, the forced uplift in the Western Ghats weakens. So as the moisture uplift reduces, the forced orographically forced precipitation decreases, and this we see generally in this southern part of the Western Ghats, the southern and the central parts. To the north it reduces, and so where the orographic effect is probably less. That is my thinking. And so there may be a orographic effect on this contrasting pattern, and also the responses and on the leeward side and the windward side of the wind flow. We have to keep that in mind. So what kind of circulation patterns develop on the, because there's a north-south oriented orography. Now there's and the flow over the Western Ghats is very gentle. It's a gentle southwest. This is what Shige and other people, they talk about. So the updraft is going to be very gentle. And usually the clouds are also shallow. So the main point that Shige et al. Has been emphasizing in the Western, and also many studies have shown recently, Western Ghat clouds are more shallow, but they can produce heavy precipitation. That is the key point. And so the orographic contribution, we really need to understand how it varies, the orographic precipitation along these north-south Western Ghats. And what about other aerosol species like black carbon, organics? What are their effects? See, I this is one thing I just give a very qualitative answers. Some of these absorbing aerosols like the black carbon, they tend to stabilize. The sulfate is more of a scattering type of aerosol, which dominates the mid-latitude areas of the northern hemisphere. Coming, these are mostly the emissions from North America, Europe, and Asia, and they are mostly scattering. So the cooling is very strong both in the atmosphere and at the surface. And now these absorbing type of aerosols, including dust, which is a natural aerosol, and sometimes the dust can be coated with black carbon. So in the lower layers, if you have these type of absorbing aerosols, because they increase the heating, because people have also studied the radiative heating due to these aerosols. So they absorb the incoming shortwave radiation. In the low, and because they are typically at low 2 to 3 kilometers above the surface, they reduce the radiation reaching the surface. So surface you may get a cooling, but the heating above this 2-3 kilometers or 3-4 kilometers above the surface, due to that heating, it warms the layer. So you have a cooler surface and a warmer warmer lower troposphere. So this means you are basically increasing the static stability. And if you increase the static stability, the circulation, tropical circulation, can weaken. And this is what we have found in one of our paper, which was published again by Ayanthika et al. So the absorbing type of aerosols, they increase the static stability, they slow down the winds, especially over the Arabian Sea. And if the winds slow down, the evaporation, because the evaporation also depends not only on the surface temperature, it also depends on the wind speed. So wind speed, if it reduces, the moisture also, evaporation also reduces. The moisture convergence will reduce, so precipitation will reduce. So that is my very simple thing. And I don't want to go into other things like sea salt and things. It's more complicated, a simple answer. Whether dimming effect show any spatial pattern strong over the, yeah. So the dimming effect is, you know, in general, what many people have studied is, because you are, so northern hemisphere, if you are trying to dim and you are having warming, GHG warming dominating in the southern hemisphere, so there is an energy imbalance. And many people are telling that if you cool one hemisphere compared to the other, from the ITCZ dynamics, the ITCZ will shift southward. This is the main issue. And I also showed how the energy transport associated with the ITCZ, I already discussed that. It will transport the energy basically in the upper branches of the Hadley cell. So when you are cooling one of the hemisphere relative to the other, the ITCZ will tend to shift southward. So that is a big signal. That is from a global perspective. And when you look at region to region, it can be very, very different. Just a minute. Hello, Chitra. Just in a warming scenario. And of course, regionally, over South Asia, East Asia, and West, there could be differences because of the differences in the regional monsoonal patterns. And also, the effect of dimming also is seen in some of the highlight. For example, over the East Asian region, also we see the effect of dimming on the precipitation. And in fact, we use the entire northern hemispheric land monsoon precipitation. That is the Paulson et al. Work. In a warming scenario, South Asia is proposed to increase, but how the law will respond to it? That's a good question. And in fact, this is what I raised. Many models are telling circulation will weaken, but we don't know. This basically boils down to the point how the convection will change, how the latent heating, how well we are able to represent in the model, and how the circulation is going to change. So it is an interaction between how good realistically models are able to represent convection, moisture processes, clouds, circulation and precipitation. All that it's a, that is what is going to determine how the circulation will change in future. That is what I think so. This is still a topic that needs research. And what is the other thing? What leads, okay, and see more. Does paleoclimatic study suggest stronger upwelling in the Western Arabian Sea during inter provide some independent evidence? Yeah. In fact, there was a long, there is a study long back by Gupta et al. They looked at these upwelling proxies from the coast of Oman and several other flight men and other people. So they say that during the, but that is mostly a proxy for the wind, the upwelling based on the G bulloids and so this is a of the foraminifera. So they, it's a proxy for upwelling in the Western Arabian Sea from the, in the coast of Oman and Arabia. So they say that when the monsoon winds intensify, it leads to stronger upwelling along the coast. But then, of course, there are different views. People are looking at proxies based on precipitation. They have a different view. But in general, the paleoclimatic evidences, some of them, they say that warmer climates tend to favor increased. So when the global climate is warm, monsoons are projected to be stronger compared to colder climates. And why greenhouse gas warming will dominate in the coming years and not aerosols? Yeah, so generally aerosol, because I think there are going to be, aerosol has been mitigated in many places globally. And there are plans to, because and it's a short-lived climate forces. So it is possible to reduce aerosol emissions. And so if that happens, but GHG is a long-lived gas, it's going to continue. And so the depending on what and the concentrations are going to be dictated by what pathway we are going to take in the future. So GHG forcing will be there in the coming century and maybe even beyond. But the aerosols will be diminishing depending on the policies of the government, what they are going to take. And if that is going to reduce slowly in the middle and long future, future, we expect that the effect of the GHG forcing will be dominating. Black carbon aerosols remain, it will be an uncertainty for more regional scale processes, local processes, it will remain an uncertainty. But I am sure it also depends on what mitigatory actions we are going to take. And are these changes noted in other, in these monsoon features such as metropospheric cyclones and how they're, that's an excellent question. I think we are planning to do that as part of it's one of our PhD students, how this climate change can affect extreme rains over Maharashtra, Gujarat due to the MTCs, and what can be the large scale constraints that may be driving. This is something we are also working. Yeah. So yeah, there are many topics for research. That's what I want to say. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Thank Krishna. You have answered all the questions. There are many more questions, but I request the audience kindly post your question as email to Dr. Krishnan. I hope he will be happy to answer you. Due to time restriction, we need to close the session now. Yeah. Thank you so much once again, Dr. Krishnan. We thank you on behalf of the MOES webinar series and for giving an excellent talk and sparing your valuable time with us. Yeah. And I also thanks all the audience for staying with us. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Vinu. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah.